You're going to tell everybody to come up and... Where's my Brenda? Is my Brenda getting close? I think so.
Just a quick note.
Talk to me.
When you are introducing this,
got it.
You already know all about
that. Everyone goes live. There's no. Good morning, everyone. As you make your way in, the first note that I'll tell you is that we are an absolutely full house today. So get cozy, get comfortable, get to know your neighbors, and fill every seat. So we will anticipate that all seats will be filled. So I'll give people just a couple minutes to straggle in, and then we'll get rolling. Quite in the line of fire. All right, so I guess we'll get started. Thank you everyone for coming. Before we start, we just acknowledge that we are here, obviously in Vancouver, but also on unceded land of the Musqueam, Salish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. So thank you everybody for coming, both live and on the streaming site. As you can see, we have a full house, so lots of attendees. I think we're close to or up over 200 total attendees this year, and that's great. So really happy about that. Representation from all over the place. I know we touted as a Western Canadian meeting, but we do have people joining us from PEI, so at least they got to sleep in a little bit. I'm going to go through a little bit of housekeeping and a few things just to get things organized. The first thing that people probably care about the most is dinner. So dinner is going to be held at the Delta at the Innes Thompson Ballroom, which is on the second floor. You will look at your ID badges, and if you've registered for dinner, you'll have a blue ticket on the back. So if you have a blue ticket, you can come for dinner. That's 5:15, dinner by 6, and there is a cash bar. The next thing I'd like to do is just offer out a few thank yous to some people that without whom we can't actually have a meeting. So we've had a great organizing committee this year, done a lot of work to get things going. So a quick thank you to the organizing committee. I think it looks like a really great program. Lots of breadth of topics, and I think we'll have a good meeting this year. Our sponsors, very important that they're there. You will notice their booths downstairs where the food is. So please stop by, say hi to the sponsor, see what they have to offer. Our platinum sponsors this year are Baxter and Fresenius, our silver sponsors, Amgen, Otsuka, Nurse Next Door, Medtronic, and Janssen. So again, please do stop by. The meeting is now in its 26th year, and there are some very special thank yous that come out to the four nephrologists that really helped get the whole meeting started, and that's Adrian Fine, George Polipchuk from Manitoba and Saskatchewan, Mernal Dasgupta, who might be here at some point if he's not here yet, from Alberta, who we'll see, and Paul Taylor here from Vancouver. I'm going to steal my chair's prerogative and take a minute to just offer a personal thank you to Paul. Some of you may or may not know that Paul will be retiring from his clinical nephrology practice in June of this year. Paul has spent a few years, because I'm really not that old, as a colleague and a mentor. So it's been a great privilege to work with him for a number of years. So on a personal note, thank you for helping getting this meeting going. Thank you for all that you have done, not only for me, but for your patients in BC and for the nephrology community at large. So thank you, Paul. The other thing that we'll just let know for questions as we go, in the house, everybody's got a microphone button in front of them. Please don't all push them at the same time. If you do, we'll hear all of you. There is no real sequencing of the mic, so you won't get put in a hold sequence. So what I would ask is, if you have a question when we get to question time, is raise a hand. Once you're acknowledged, you can then push your mic, turn it on, and when you're finished, turn it off. Please do turn your mics on so that people that are watching the streaming can follow. For those of you live streaming, on the right-hand side of your screen, there will be an area where you can enter questions. Theoretically, I will be monitoring that and try to get your questions done. If something fails, Brenda's there to help me. At the end, we will have an online evaluation and survey for the event, so please do fill that out. It is very important. We use that a lot in our planning for future years. And for CME credits, you will get 11.25 credits for the full 2 days. Couple other little things. The presentations will be posted at wcpddays.ca if anybody wants them. Also remember that ISPD is here. I don't see Daniel yet, but do follow ISPD on Twitter if you're not. At ISPD 2018, don't forget to register for that meeting. Also looks like a great meeting. Couple little housekeeping things, name tags. So they like you to wear your name tag, so please do wear it. And don't leave anything lying around unattended. Finally, before I get Dr. Verrelli up, one last thank you to the BC Provincial Renal Agency. And the group that's done all the work. The planning committee does a lot of work getting it together, but we really have the easy part of the job. The hard work is done by the two ladies standing at the back, hiding there, trying not to be noticed, Claire and Brenda. And Claire's really taken the lion's share. Stephanie in the past years has helped us out, but Stephanie's been seconded by the ISPD. So Claire took this on and did a masterful job getting it all together. So without Claire, this doesn't happen. She's really done the bulk of the work getting this together. So Claire, from me and from the group, thank you. And I have clearly spoken enough now, so without much else, I will take the opportunity to introduce Dr. Mauro Verrelli from Manitoba, who is going to talk to us about peritonitis. He'll lead, and then we'll introduce Cheryl Zelenitsky, hopefully I got it right, Cheryl, who will also follow. So Mauro, again, is somebody who I have a long history with. Mauro was one of my mentors when I trained for nephrology in Winnipeg, continues to be very active at St. Boniface, really took the reins from Dr. Fine, continues to have a great PD presence, as well as a great presence in the Division of Nephrology in Manitoba. Most of you know him. He's been on our organizing committee for a number of years and really doesn't need much of an introduction. So with that, I'll invite Mauro up to start the conference off.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Abid, for the kind introduction. Well, it's my pleasure being here. It's always beautiful to be in Vancouver this time of year. This is a new venue. It's beautiful. It's nice to see everybody around in a nice circle so that we can actually face each other. So when we were doing our committee work, we were brainstorming on what the topics might be. And we believe this is probably a timely topic just because it's been at least six years since our last guidelines were published by the ISPD. And it's a moment to just reflect and see what's new, what's not new, what creates a bit of a framework in our day-to-day work when it comes to treating peritonitis. So once again, this is mostly a review. This is material that's very well known to most of you. So I was hoping not to make this something that might make you fall asleep. So I decided I was going to make this interactive. I do think that most of the work that is very well known is definitely something that needs a bit of framework, a bit of context, and structure as to why we do things. And when we're in our busy environments of delivering care, sometimes we just know that Mr. X has had his catheter removed and he needs this to be done, but we don't quite go back and say, well, why did this happen? Why did did we do it this way? These guidelines really help structure that, and I think they're worth review, even if there's aspects of them that are definitely not new. I hope to highlight some practical principles. I hope to discuss some areas of controversy and ponder some of the newer things possibly that have been introduced. One of the things I'm not going to do is get into the specifics of antibiotic treatment, because I think that it really, this is a very broad topic, and that adds on to this very broad topic as it is. And I think that on a day-to-day basis, we do that very well. We can easily go back to the guidelines and look that up. But I'm not going to do that for the sake of time, and I think there's enough there for you to follow up on if you do choose to do that. One of the things that I needed to highlight is that the recommendations the guidelines specifically say that these recommendations are not meant to be implemented in every situation indiscriminately. So you really need to look at your environment. You need a springboard of what these recommendations tell us, and then say, is this something I'm going to be able to use in my environment? This is, we talk about the International Society of Peritoneal Dialysis. We are in Canada. We are in our own province, in our own community, in our own hospital. So we really have to scrutinize what it is we do and really try to deliver the care that is most appropriate for our patients, hoping that these guidelines will, in fact, guide us. The recommendations are evidence-based where they can be. And unfortunately, in nephrology, evidence sometimes is hard to come by, but at least we have some consensus and some structure that we can say, okay, well, this is where I can start off, as I just mentioned, and try to apply what I can locally. The guidelines use the grade system for classification of their recommendations and what they have as evidence for their strength of recommendation. So if they think that you really need to be doing this, they say, we recommend, that's a level one strength recommendation. Or if they say, well, we suggest, that's a little softer, it's level two, and then at times there's the stuff that isn't even graded. So in degree of strength of recommendation, it's level one down all the way to non-graded. And to support that that strength that they're suggesting or recommending, there's evidence, and that evidence goes from high quality all the way down to low quality, A, B, C, D, and they tell us what, why they'll tell us, well, we suggest, and they'll say the level of evidence is C, low quality. And so it gives us a bit of an idea of where we really should be thinking this is really something that we should be doing, or rather, we probably need to look a little closer locally to see if in fact this is something worthwhile, just because the evidence really quite may not be there. So I thought I would just run a bit of a string of slides as to some of the questions that I often will hear nurses in particular ask me. They'll say, well, there's a new catheter out there. Why don't we use that? We're having a lot of primary malfunctioning catheters. We should probably try that one, because I heard that in this particular part of the world or in this province they're using that and it seems to be better. Where is the evidence for some of these things? Where is there clear evidence? Where is there not any evidence? And I thought I'd just, based on the guidelines, I'm going to run through a string of these things and just let you know what is out there. By the way, the way I've structured this talk, it doesn't quite follow necessarily the way the guidelines are written up, and there's a reason for that. It's because I thought it might be worth just highlighting some of the key points and not necessarily, you know, making this a monotonous review of every point in the sequence that has been provided by the actual paper. So, catheter placement, preventing peritonitis when we place catheters. Well, there's very good evidence that if you give systemic prophylactic antibiotics when you insert these catheters, you're going to prevent early infection. It's a recommendation, it's a level one recommendation, and it's strong evidence, it's A. So I think that is something we can be very solid about, and I'm almost certain that all our programs already do this, but that is something we can feel very good about, saying there's good evidence to do this. Connection methods. If some of you have been around long enough, you will recall that before the flush before fill Y system, and I'm a physician, I don't really deal with the connectology very well, but I definitely see a lot of the end results of these kinds of things. And you might recall, for those of you who were around at the time, that peritonitis was huge. The rates of peritonitis was dramatically decreased by this Y connector, flush before fill connector, and it dramatically reduced peritonitis rates. And so the evidence for that is definitely very strong, and it's something that I'm, again, once very certain that we do in our CAPD patients. Okay. Exit site care. So these days, again, in Canada, I would hope that we're all using prophylaxis. There's very good evidence for that in the application of mupirocin. There are observational and several RCTs that suggest that applying mupirocin cream to the exit site reduces exit site infections and likely peritonitis. You can also use gentamicin. There is one randomized controlled study that basically says that you can use gentamicin instead of mupirocin and still able to reduce Staph aureus infections besides Pseudomonas, which was intended to look at when it was first done. So definitely that's something that we should all be doing. It's a 1B recommendation. Recommend prompt treatment of exit site or catheter tunnel infection to reduce subsequent peritonitis risk. I think that's an implicit, and I think it's a 1C recommendation, so there's a low relatively low level of evidence, but I think it makes common sense in spite of the lack of evidence, because like I said before, we're not always going to find evidence for things just because the studies haven't been done. Catheter design. This is what I was alluding to before. There is no specific recommendation on catheter design for prevention of peritonitis. So if anybody's wondering about that question, it is very clear that there's no one catheter out there, although there are some reports of an occasional catheter. For example, I can think of the weighted catheter that they use in Europe, the self-directing catheter, where there's been reports of lesser peritonitis. But let's just say that when you look at the big spectrum of studies, the evidence isn't there for anything particular that's going to prevent peritonitis from, or many other things from a perspective of the type of catheter you're using. Oh, sorry, I got to go back. Insertion technique. So the studies that have been looked at have been, there was a large systematic review that looked at laparoscopic, peritoneoscopic insertions versus laparotomy, and really found no differences in the large spectrum of literature that said that one insertion technique is better than the other in preventing peritonitis. And what we seem to also glean from the literature is that in general, insertion technique is not relevant to a lot of other aspects of patient outcomes. But we do know that, for example, the experience of the operator, whether it is something that we do percutaneously, whether it is something that we do laparoscopically or surgically, the experience of the center, the volume of procedures, and the experience of the operator doing the procedure, that really affects outcome, but not necessarily the procedure itself. Dialysis solutions, no evidence that it's going to be of any benefit, whatever solution we're using when it comes to preventing peritonitis. Okay, so this is our first case. I have a bunch of cases, and I'm hoping we can make this interactive so we don't all fall asleep. And I've taken some typical cases we might encounter in a day-to-day practice, and then I ask you a question, and I'm hoping I get some responses. And the bolded question is the one that's most immediate, and I'm hoping to get an answer for with the upcoming slides. So there's a 75-year-old woman who has end-stage renal disease secondary to ischemic nephropathy. She's been on PD for a year. She was admitted to hospital for GI bleeding. She undergoes colonoscopy and is found to have diverticulosis. Her bleeding stops and hemoglobin stabilizes, but 48 hours later, she develops peritonitis. CT scan, I guess they were trying to figure out whether she had a perforated bowel or not, is normal, but PD effluent grows E. coli. And the question to you that we should all wonder about is, could her peritonitis have been prevented? Any thoughts on that? Yes.
Possibly using prophylactic antibiotic before the procedure?
Thank you. So that is exactly the point I'm trying to raise here. And that is something that we have to think about. So we know from the literature that invasive procedures such as colonoscopy, such as gynecological procedures, and many other procedures that involve possibly causing bacteremias can cause peritonitis. We know that. What we don't know is what we can do possibly to fix that problem. So I've put up the recommendations in the 2011 guidelines, which is the second statement, and then I'm going to show you, and on the first line there is the more 2016 more recent ones. So we've gone from 2011 stating invasive gastrointestinal procedures may infrequently cause peritonitis in PD patients. Intravenous antibiotic prophylaxis reduces early peritonitis in these patients. Two, we suggest, so this is, again, it's a middle ground strength of recommendation. We suggest, not we recommend, it's level two. Antibiotic prophylaxis prior to colonoscopy, and the level of evidence is so the strength of recommendation is not that strong, and the level of evidence is low. Not very low, but low. So it's an invasive gynecological procedures. So when you look at the literature to support that recommendation, what you find is two studies. They're small. One is a series of 97 patients who underwent colonoscopy. In that group, those who got peritonitis and had received antibiotics had a lower incidence of peritonitis in number, and those who hadn't had a larger, higher incidence. But when you actually looked at the statistical significance of those two groups, it was not there. So it wasn't statistically significant. The numbers, the power to look at that wasn't there. And let's just say that that really isn't solid evidence. And the other one is another small study, small numbers, looking at a variety of invasive procedures where they were prophylaxed and it looked like there was some possible benefit. But once again, it wasn't powered to show any statistical significance. So yes, in theory, we can do that. We can try to do this, but the evidence isn't there. So I'm curious because we don't do it at our center. And so I'm curious, with a show of hands, how many centers actually do this in Canada, in at least Western Canada? Yeah, so very interesting. Thank you. That's great. So here we are to learn something about each other, and it's, I think, something to bring home to think about. Okay? And once again, here's some other comments that I found in the article. Transient bacteremia is common after dental procedures and may lead to peritonitis. Prophylactic antibiotics before extensive dental procedures may be reasonable. So if you look at the Canadian Dental Association SBE, the endocarditis prophylaxis guidelines or recommendations, we definitely don't have anything with PD. We don't have our own evidence for this. And again, we in our own center, we don't do this. I honestly cannot remember a single episode of having seen a patient who'd gone for cleaning of their teeth with peritonitis. That doesn't mean anything because it probably happens. But again, does anybody in this environment, do you folks know if in your, yeah, very interesting. Okay. All right. Next, other modifiable risk factors. So wet contamination, I think we probably all do that. And again, there's no widely accepted antibiotic regimen that we give people for wet contamination. Most folks will give a couple days' worth of oral antibiotics. Sometimes we give IP, whatever we feel comfortable with. But again, as long as we're doing it, I think we're probably preventing peritonitis, but again, the evidence is not there. Training programs. So we know that education of our patients is extremely important in ensuring that they do what they possibly can in following sterile technique and all those wonderful things that they're supposed to be doing to prevent infection. The evidence for this, though, in fact, unfortunately, is not there. So the way we should be training these patients, the way what specific protocols they should be, it's really not there. But the ISPD has, in fact, published another set of guidelines, which I presume, I would hope, most nurses would have seen. And that is the reference that I have there, and that second bullet, I put it there specifically so you can go to refer to it if you haven't seen it. And that is basically a Judy Bernardini published that last year. She was one of the authors on that guideline. And it basically gives you a bit of a structure on the kinds of things that you should be doing to ensure that your patients are learning their technique well and they're, that we're following a standardized protocol. But again, the evidence for a lot of this stuff is unfortunately not there, but it makes good sense, and at a consensus level, the ISPD current guidelines basically say you should be following the latest recommendations for teaching PD patients and their caregivers. PD training should be conducted by nursing staff with appropriate qualifications and experience. That makes total sense. We wouldn't want anybody doing peritoneal dialysis on our patients who has, we come across family members who think they're going to be able to do it, who've never seen a PD catheter, those kinds of things. We obviously want to make sure we have the right people training patients, people with the expertise. Next case, a 55-year-old man with end-stage renal disease secondary to chronic glomerulonephritis has been on PD for 2 years. He develops peritonitis, and the PD effluent grows Staphylococcus epidermidis. He's successfully treated with a 2-week course of IP vancomycin, and the PD fluid readily clears after 48 hours. 2 weeks after terminating his antibiotics, the PD effluent becomes cloudy. So I thought I would take an opportunity here for us to just review what is the differential diagnosis of cloudy effluent. Obviously, in this case, I think the index of suspicion for this being an infection is going to be high, but what else could happen in patients when they present with cloudy fluid? What else could be causing cloudy fluid? Okay. So I didn't want to have you ponder this too long for the sake of time, but I thought I'd just put it up. So obviously it can be something infectious, and it could be culture positive or culture negative. I put this in a sequence that is not quite the way it's listed on the guidelines table, just because I think this is probably what we come across more frequently in order of frequency. So culture positive or negative, the specimen has been taken from a dry abdomen. We all know that if somebody has, you drain their fluid after they haven't had anything in their abdomen for a couple days, you're going to have a high cell count there. And then we reinstill solution and we flush it out, we reinstill and we let it sit there for a couple hours to see if we have somebody with a true high cell count. Hemoperitoneum, so bleeding, eosinophilia. Honestly, I'm not sure if I've ever seen this, but I can imagine we see it possibly when people get things like allergic reactions to icodextrin. Possibly, I just don't honestly remember having seen this. Calcium channel blockers. That's another one I don't think I've ever seen. Be interesting to. That's something that's listed. Malignancy. Again, yes, definitely you can see that in malignancy. Often the cell count though is may likely not be neutrophils, but other types of cells like macrophages and possibly even malignant cells. Obviously, chemical peritonitis. So a lot of this stuff is pretty rare. We don't really see it, but it's something for us to keep in mind as a care provider that it's not always peritonitis. Just keep it in mind. That we really think out of the box, because sometimes what is common is generally common, but there are the red herrings. So the next question on this, and the bolded one, is this refractory, relapsing, repeat, or recurrent peritonitis? And I still struggle with these things, but we have to really keep this framework going because it really has implications in the way we treat our patients. So I thought I'd take the opportunity to list this and have us just review what these terms mean and what we eventually do with these things. So refractory is, of course, when you are treating your patient with antibiotics and within 5 days that fluid isn't clear. We know we have to deal with it differently. Relapsing is when you've treated your patient and within 4 weeks of terminating therapy, the same organism grows or it's culture negative. Because remember, if it's culture negative, it may not mean that there's no bug. It just may mean that you weren't able to grow it. And in this particular case, maybe because you've just finished treating the patient and there isn't enough of a mass of organisms to be able to grow them. Repeat peritonitis more than 4 weeks after you finished your treatment for your initial episode with the same organism. Recurrent, within 4 weeks, different organisms. And catheter-related, well, catheter-related is when we know that there's been something going on with the exit side of the tunnel. And so this is the classification the ISPD uses, and it's something for us to, even though we can't always remember these darn R's, because I still struggle with them, it's nice to go back to them and just say, you know, which one am I dealing with here? So just to put this in a bit of context, a couple years ago, we created a standardized antibiotic treatment protocol within our PD unit with all basically taking out the ISPD guidelines. And we actually have these things listed there with a checkbox to have the nephrologist who's ordering the protocol once the cultures are back to try to identify what this is. Because as you are going back in that chart, if you actually find these, particularly if you have a relapsing over and over again, it implies a certain care path for that patient, which we'll get into in a few minutes. The other thing that we need to keep an eye on here is that when people are doing statistics on reporting their episodes of peritonitis, relapsing episodes should not be counted as another episode. So just keep that in mind, otherwise your stats are going to be a lot worse than they actually are. Recurrent and repeat, of course, should be counted. So this man has recurrent peritonitis, so it's within 2 weeks, but he has a new bug, and it's yeast. How are we going to manage this patient? I'll wait for the answer this time. Yes, I don't see the hand, but where is it? Yes, please. Yes. Yes, we're going to remove the catheter. Okay. So the guidelines say we recommend, so a very strong level of recommendation, that immediate catheter removal when fungi are identified. And we suggest treatment with an appropriate antifungal agent for 2 weeks beyond catheter removal. So the level of evidence there is both low. One recommendation is very strong, the first one. The second one is more of a moderate recommendation. But I think we probably all do both these things in our environments. Could this episode of peritonitis have been avoided? I don't see any red lights blinking. Could this have been avoided? Yes.
With the use of antifungal treatment with the antibiotics?
Thank you. That's the answer I was looking for. So I want to point out what the recommendations said in 2011. So we'll start with the third bullet. And then what they say now. So in 2011, they said, fungal prophylaxis during antibiotic therapy may prevent some cases of candida peritonitis in programs that have high rates of fungal peritonitis. 2011. In 2016, they're saying, we recommend, so strong recommendation, antifungal prophylaxis when PD patients receive antibiotic courses to prevent fungal peritonitis. So they say that this is a strong recommendation, and the level of evidence is B, moderate. What I find very interesting about this recommendation is this. So in 2011, they had a randomized control trial so a best evidence trial, and they had a meta-analysis that was done in 2004, which used primarily that RCT to say that things were effective. So that was in 2011. And in 2016, we have one more RCT, which came out in 2010, and now the recommendation has gone to be quite strong compared to 2011. So let's look at some of this evidence to help us understand if this is really something we should be doing. So in 2010, somebody by the name of Restrepo in Colombia did a randomized control study. He used 420 patients. One was in a control group where they got no antifungal treatment. The other group got fluconazole every 48 hours. There were both APD and CAPD patients in the mix. When they looked at patient characteristics, there were really no differences. And when they looked at outcomes, they were looking at primary fungal peritonitis, and I'll get into what that means in a second, and then secondary or antibiotic-associated fungal peritonitis. And they defined that as someone who had terminated antibiotics, and after 30 days of terminating antibiotics for their bacterial peritonitis, so more, greater than 30 days and less than 150 days, if they developed a yeast peritonitis within that time frame, they were considered to be antibiotic-associated. Otherwise, they were considered to be fungal peritonitis. The thing that they did here, though, is that they treated these patients primarily if they had bacterial peritonitis. So if they had other antibiotics for other indications, they were not prophylaxed. Just keep that in mind. And the definition of primary and secondary, or primary and antibiotic-related, is random, because there really isn't any validated definition out there. So that when you look at the results, they had, in this time frame of about 3 years, they had 434 peritonitis episodes. 32 of them were fungal, and 14 of them were considered to be primary. Primary meaning not antibiotic associated. So they had 18 antibiotic associated episode according to that definition, and in the treatment group, they had only 3 episodes. In the control group, so the group that was not treated, they had 15 episodes. And that, you know, is statistically significant. And so on that basis, one might say that, yes, this is a good evidence that, you know, prophylaxing with bacterial peritonitis, prophylaxing them with antifungal agents is worthwhile. But then we have to think about this a little bit further. Okay, so one nice thing about this study is that they really reported that the fluconazole was well tolerated. There was no side effects or serious adverse events. They had a very high baseline rate of peritonitis. So the recommended ISPD baseline rate is at most 0.5. There was 0.63. In Canada, I think most of us are probably in the 0.2 to 0.3 range. But this was pretty high to start off with. And so you have to wonder how that contributed to this outcome of fungal peritonitis. These patients were not getting exit site prophylaxis. You have to wonder what that has to do with it. They live in a different climate. This is Colombia. It is a warm climate. There's no seasonal variation. And we know in some of the literature that fungal peritonitis is affected by seasonal variation. How does that then correlate? How is that applicable to a Canadian climate? We don't know. I question the issue about the definition of greater than 30 days and less than 150 as that being antibiotic related, because what if somebody got something at 2 weeks after they terminated, what if they got yeast infection at 2 weeks after they terminated antibiotics? Does that mean that it wasn't antibiotic associated? I don't know. I have some difficulty with that, because I would have said yes. But again, how that factors into all this, I don't know, but it just makes you wonder. And what about patients who had other indications for antibiotics? So if somebody came in with, if somebody had a cholecystitis and got put on antibiotics, if they had some other infection, are they primary? Because we didn't quite look at it. So again, I don't know how that all factors in, and if that... If all these question marks, makes me feel very confident that, in fact, this is something that we have to adopt. In 1996, There was a Hong Kong study led by Dr. Low. This again was almost 400 patients. They here used nystatin. And here they used the drug while the patient was on any antibiotic treatment. They had a follow-up of about 18 months in the treatment group, 16.8 months in the control group. And they basically looked at candida peritonitis, peritonitis-free survival, and antibiotic-related candida peritonitis. And here they defined it occurring with it less than 3 months after terminating antibiotics. So if the same criteria were used in the other study, those patients of greater than 30 days, of less than 30 days, would have fit into this category of antibiotic associated. So that shows you that there is, you know, some discrepancy in how we look at this stuff. Results. There were 188 episodes of peritonitis in the control group, 216 in the treatment group. There were 12 episodes of fungal peritonitis in the control group, 4 episodes, so much less in the treatment group. And they defined this as episodes per 100 cases of peritonitis, so 1.43 per 100 peritonitis cases on the control group and 0.66 in the treatment group. But when you look at this outcome statistically, it really was not statistically significant. So looking at these two studies, which are really what they're using for evidence into that strong recommendation, I have some difficulty saying this is the definite way to go. Once again, nystatin in this particular study was well tolerated. The positive effect of nystatin was not statistically significant. All but one of the episodes of fungal peritonitis occurred between April to October in Hong Kong. So it does suggest a seasonal scenario. And if it is the case, how does that apply, for example, to Canada? We don't know. So I'm very fortunate. I work with a wonderful group of people at St. Boniface Hospital and within the Manitoba Renal Program. And Callie Kochuk, one of our PharmD students, very diligently did some very hard work for us. When we asked this question, what are we going to do with this? Because this is something obviously has implications with patient care and outcomes. And of course, Christine Davis was supervising her, our PharmD at St. Boniface Hospital. And so we did a cross-Canada survey. They did a cross-Canada survey. And it turns out that only one site revisited the question of whether antifungal prophylaxis is necessary based on the new recommendations and new guidelines. And in the entire country, these are mostly large centers across the country. Most of them, I would venture to say, are tertiary. I just numbered them. But there's only one center in this country that actually prophylaxes everybody, and most others are either not doing it at all, or they're just treating people who they consider to be high risk, and high risk is generally considered someone who's immunosuppressed with possibly immunosuppressive agents or other reasons, or somebody who's been on prolonged antibiotics for possibly recurrent bacterial peritonitis or other things that require prolonged courses of antibiotics. So most of the comments we received from each site was that they have very low numbers, so 2 cases in 7 years, 1 case in 2014. Let's just say that the numbers that report are considered to be very low. We don't have the actual, you know, episode per patient year, but that's the sense we have in this country, at least at this point in time. And how many programs that you all represent actually have a standardized we captured most of the country, but a show of hands for people who do this on a routine basis? Okay, thank you. All right, so this is St. Boniface Hospital peritonitis data, and this fungal peritonitis data, and thanks again to Callie, Christine, and actually I have to thank, my gosh, I'm having a blank moment. But thank you for this table. But it basically tells us that we have some fluctuation in, so if you look at the last column, you'll see that we have 0.03 episodes per patient year within sort of that spectrum, but often significantly less with some fluctuation over the years. Whether we consider that low or not is a bit of a question mark, because I guess any episode is bad. But there is some trend for consistency within a range. Don't try to read this. It's very, very difficult to read for the small print. I just put it up here to just show you that the two randomized control trials we spoke about are up there. Callie also looked at all the baseline control and treatment groups of the non-randomized studies that exist when it comes to fungal prophylaxis. So there are many other studies out there, but they're really showing mixed results, leading us to believe that prophylaxis based on those studies is an inconclusive entity when it comes to actually doing it. But what's interesting about all those studies, and if you can't see the numbers, is that both their baseline peritonitis rates and their fungal peritonitis rates are pretty high compared to St. Boniface, for example. You're looking at rates there in some areas of, for example, if you look at the fifth study down, 2.7 episodes per patient year for the control group, that's like astronomically high. And even in their treatment group, they had 0.7. St. Boniface's rate this year is like 0.37, and that's more or less what we have over the years. But if you look at many of those, their baseline rates are significantly higher. Again, even if some of those studies which are non-randomized suggest that there is benefit, how can we really extrapolate their outcomes to our own environments? I just find a bit of difficulty with that. Okay, so go to the bolded area once again. The PD patients, the patient's PD catheter, yes.
So just a general comment on sort of how we apply the guidelines, right? So that's a pretty big change from 2011 to 2016 to a full recommendation, right?
Yeah.
And just looking across the room, not many people are applying that recommendation. And that's based on what we believe to be the quality of the evidence or the applicability of the evidence that's actually being used to derive the guideline. So I think, from a perspective of, Canadian or even Western peritoneal dialysis programs who have low PD, low fungal PD peritonitis rates, it's very hard to actually adopt that, to inherently put everyone onto antifungal prophylaxis when we have such low rates to begin with that don't compare anywhere to that Colombian study that was used to derive some of the guideline. And particularly if we look at it, maybe the guideline's now 1B because simply we're looking at it from an international perspective. It is the ISPD guidelines. It's not right. The Canadian guidelines or Western Canadian guidelines, right?
I would tend to agree with you. This is my personal opinion. I would tend to agree that we really need to look at this and say, this is, like I've been saying it all along, this is really applied to us. But it's very interesting because there's different viewpoints on this, and we have one major center in this country that does this on a routine basis. And the philosophy, my understanding, is that even if you have one episode, if it could have been prevented, would have been worth that blanket giving everybody prophylaxis. But the question that keeps bothering me is, do we have the proof that by doing this, we actually would have prevented that? Yes.
Hey, Mauro. So at our center, we don't routinely give everybody, again, for the same reasons that Dr. Prakal was saying. I think the places that decide to do it, even if they have low rates of fungus, I guess would probably be based on the fact that it basically necessitates an automatic leaving from PD.
Yeah.
And for the most part, I'd be interested in seeing, most of those patients can't come back to PD because fungal peritonitis is free. Poor, associated with not very good outcome. Even when they transfer to hemodialysis, they have a high morbidity and mortality.
Yeah.
So the argument would just be that the severity of that event is worth the prophylaxis of everybody. Although I agree that every time you give anybody antifungals regularly too, you have some things that might come down the road because of that.
Well, there's resistance issues now with the azoles, right? And we aren't entirely convinced that that intervention is actually going to prevent that episode. That's my problem. If I were convinced, I would absolutely do that. But that's just my thought. Okay. So the catheter was removed. He was treated for 3 more weeks with antifungals. And the question now is, and you just alluded to this, should this patient ever go back to PD? Thoughts? Okay, show of hands, those who think this patient should go back on PD. Okay, show of hands, I guess there's no abstention here, folks, okay? So it's either yes or no. All right. So this is a study that comes out of University Health Network by Joanne and her group, Joanne Bargman. And they looked at about 10 years' worth of data on fungal peritonitis patients, and they were able to put the absolute numbers in this era were, say, 36 patients, and a third of them ended up back on PD. I went through the paper and I couldn't quite garner from it what prevented the others from like for the definitive transfers, et cetera. But I guess the point of this is that a third of these patients were back on PD. And it's interesting because in my career, I was in an era with Adrian Fine where everybody got put back on PD. And then we got some new colleagues who said, well, this guy has had fungal peritonitis. He can't go back on PD. And I thought, well, okay, maybe I'm just getting old and not up to speed with the data and literature, but I don't, why is that a problem? And now we've come full circle. We really do give people that opportunity. So you might all remember that when people have these kinds of peritonitis, their morbidity can be very high. As you can see, there's a 20% mortality there, often higher. It can be as high as 40% from what I recall. The issue is that there's a lot of inflammation and adhesions and scarring, and so what's to prevent us from putting a catheter in a patient if they really desire to go back on PD and see what happens? If there's adhesions and poor flow issues and we can't do it, great. If there are clearance issues, well, the default still remains hemo. But I think my personal opinion is I think we should give these people the option of doing that. If they so desire, because it's a quality of life issue, particularly for many of our patients who live in rural and remote environments who want to be in their home communities, which often means a move into the city miles and miles away from home. Okay, next case. So 62-year-old woman with end-stage renal disease from diabetes. She gets peritonitis, staphylococcus, epidermidis. Treated again successfully, fluid clears after 48 hours. But a week after the finishing your antibiotics, the fluid becomes cloudy again. Okay, so now I want an answer. Is this refractory, relapsing, repeat, or recurrent peritonitis? Okay. All right, we're not gonna worry about that. But I just want to keep bringing that home because I think we need to try to keep these definitions in our minds. So she has recurrent peritonitis because it's 2 weeks after her terminating antibiotics and she's growing a new bug. It's Staphylococcus aureus. How do we manage this patient? So she went from Staph epi to Staph aureus. How do we manage this patient? Okay, so those two organisms are both skin organisms. Something is probably awry with this patient's technique. We know that poor technique and all those mistakes people make will provoke peritonitis. There is decent literature out there. It's not the greatest, but it's not bad. Basically showing that within 6 months of people having been trained, they will often take shortcuts. They will not necessarily wash their hands. There's compliance issues. There's a variety of things that people do, either knowingly or unknowingly, that really predispose them to making mistakes and, of course, getting peritonitis. There's one study, one of the studies that basically supports some of this thought process comes from Italy. They did a survey and they did an inpatient home visit. And when they went to the patient's home and I started asking questions about what they were doing with their technique, they were giving answers that were wrong, but they actually believed they were correct. So people, and it makes a lot of sense because when you think about people getting educated, repetition is really key, right? I mean, it's like when you tell patients in your clinic, you know, unfortunately you're gonna end up having end-stage kidney disease, you need dialysis, and then they show up in hospital, you know, a year later after having been to the clinic many times and they didn't realize they were gonna be on dialysis. I mean, unfortunately there's a denial factor, but there's also a learning factor, and that's how we learn, repetition. So there is a role for retraining. The literature on when we should retrain, who we should retrain, how we should retrain, is really not there. It's just not there. But we're, again, trying to make an attempt on trying to define that in some reasonable way and some kind of consensus. So this is what they have listed. I actually added the first one because of that paper that I mentioned where they did the survey and visit home. So one of the ways that it could be done is by assessing the patient with a home visit. That's what they did in that particular paper. And looking at compliance, technique to make sure that things are really appropriate. And then there's a bunch of other suggestions. So following a prolonged hospitalization, following peritonitis and/or catheter infection. So this was a particular case where that would have been specifically indicated just because they were both skin organisms and they must be doing something with the technique causing that problem. Change in manual dexterity, vision, mental acuity, a change of supplier or type of connection, and interruption in PD. So for example, if they've transiently been on hemodialysis. So I suspect most programs do much of this. What I also suspect is that most programs don't have a formal standard operating procedure, but I hope I'm wrong. And if I'm wrong, we'd definitely like to know what some of these programs do if they do have a standard operating procedure on how to do this. So show of hands, programs who actually have a standard operating procedure on retraining. Good for you, that's excellent. So one of the difficulties that I come across in our environment when we talk about this is unfortunately we have a very large unit. We're at about 180 patients, and there's always a pressure on training, on assessments, because we get referrals from other sites. There's a lot of pressure on the human resource factor that this becomes another thing that we realize we need to do, but somehow with all the other priorities does take sometimes a lesser priority. But that is the challenge. It is really trying to find the appropriate time, the appropriate person, so that it doesn't really burden the environment with already, which is already overtaxed with a lot of activity. But thank you for that, and I thought that was something worth reviewing. So next patient is 70 years old, polycystic kidneys, develops, once again, Staphylococcus epidermidis peritonitis. Once again, does very well with standard IP vancomycin because it's oxacillin resistant bug. And once again, gets cloudy and asks the same question, is this refractory? You won't be able to give me the answer because I have to tell you what he grows again. And what he grows is staph epidermidis again. So he has relapsing peritonitis, and the question to you is, what is likely going on? So he had staphylococcus epidermidis, and he grew the same bug.
He could develop a biofilm on the catheter.
Yes, yes, that's exactly the answer I was looking for. And this particular bug, any coagulase negative bugs are notorious for doing this. So definitely that is something we need to consider when that happens. And how are we going to manage this patient? Anyone?
We may have to add another antibiotic.
Okay.
To try to eradicate or catheter removal.
Okay. So So that those are both correct answers. So I think most environments probably would treat this patient again, hoping to clear that solution again. And we definitely would have to consider removing that catheter. You know, we always try to make sure that patient hangs on that catheter as long as possible. So someone might treat it again for a second course and maybe for a little longer and hoping that, you know, they won't have a recurrence or a relapse. But at some point, the catheter removal is definitely something that has to be considered. So one of the things that the literature is supporting these days is that you ideally want to get so once you've established that this is likely biofilm and you're probably not going to, you know, be able to eradicate this bug and you're going to have relapsing episodes over and over again, and you need to get a catheter out, one of the best ways probably to do this is to get the patient's fluid clear, get them peritonitis free, and then have a removal and reinsertion simultaneously so you don't have to transition them to hemo. So I just thought I'd group these into one major heading just as an overview. What are the indications for catheter removal? I think these are pretty self-explanatory. Refractory, which, you know, less than 5 days. Relapsing, which we just talked about. Refractory, of course, exit sites and tunnel infections where you're not getting anywhere with usual antibiotics. Fungal peritonitis we talked about. And there's some other considerations, like for repeat. I'm not sure I've come across too many of those where I've had to remove something for repeat peritonitis unless we felt the patient was not coping and with technique and those kinds of things. Mycobacterial, I've been in both situations where the literature basically doesn't necessarily support removal, but you can, and so we've treated through and worked well, or we've over-removed because we felt probably best, but let's just say that that is a bit of a gray zone. And multiple enteric organisms, well, that's in the scenario maybe we have an acute abdominal catastrophe where there's so much else going on that if they take the patient to the OR, you might just get that catheter out if you think it's another source of infection while the person's getting over their acute episode. Okay, so this basically now just reviews the same things with level of recommendation and evidence. So refractory is level 1C. So we do that it's strongly recommended. We do that all the time, but the evidence for that is low. Relapsing, recurrent, and repeat, same kind of idea. Strong recommendation, low evidence. We suggest that it is appropriate to consider return to PD for many patients who have had their catheter removed for refractory relapsing or fungal peritonitis. So it's a 2C, so it's a suggestion, it's not a recommendation, and evidence is low. Okay, so there's a lot of variation in peritonitis rates internationally. We don't quite understand why, but the recommendation is no more than 0.5 episodes per patient year. And it depends on the patient population. Some centers are reporting very, very low rates at like 0.20 episodes per year. And I think we are probably across that spectrum, but I think we're probably in this country probably between 0.2 and 0.3s from what I can recall. Programs should be monitoring their rates at least yearly. They also suggest that we look at rates of specific organisms. And those percentage of patients that are peritonitis free in those intervals. So that's the other side, I guess. You know, what are we doing well with the patients who are not getting infected? Looking at, of course, antimicrobial susceptibilities to ensure that we're targeting these organisms with the right drugs in our own context. And monitoring in CQI, they're suggesting that we now report patient episode per year instead of the traditional reporting of, you know, one episode in X number of months. That the reason why the committee feels this way is because it's more of a linear reporting method. I guess we'll do that as we feel best in our own environment, but as long as we do it. And they strongly suggest that each center has a continuous quality improvement program to reduce peritonitis rates, and that they that a multidisciplinary team meet regularly to review their environment and to try to improve on their statistics. And we do that in our environment, and I must say that we do find a lot of, so for example, the fungal peritonitis question that I addressed here, that was raised in our quality meeting where we're saying, well, what do we do with this? This is very important. You know, are we going to take this on? We shouldn't ignore it. And at least it's brought up for discussion. Whether you adopt it or not is another question. If there's a blip in your fungal rates, for example, last year we had, 2015, we had a long run, like 6 episodes of fungal. Like, what is this going on? So we review our patients, we look at antibiotics. So I think it's worth doing. And although it's a suggestion and a moderate level recommendation and evidence in there, we find it very useful in our environment. That's it. So I'm happy to take any questions. We have 5 minutes, a little less than 5 minutes. And I think we've addressed a lot of the stuff as we went along. I try to make it interactive. So that some of these questions that we may have been thinking about already came up, but I'm again very happy to take any questions. Thank you,
Mauro. I do have a question from a live stream audience, wondering about any comments that you might have on the use of TPA or other thrombolytics for the treatment of biofilms.
So there's evidence that it was a urokinase study that suggested some improvement some positive effect in removing biofilm, and in fact being able to eradicate the organism. That is something that has been out there. I've never used it in our environment, but I must also say that the literature that supports removal and reinsertion actually shows it's a better effect. It's a stronger effect. So I think, you know, if I had to transition a patient to hemodialysis to be able to reach that endpoint, I probably would consider giving that a try, because definitely the evidence is there. But considering that most of these patients will clear up, particularly if it's a staph epi, you know, it's just pretty easy to just remove the catheter and reinsert a new one. And the success rate there, I think it was something like, I think it's like 50 to 70% success rate with urokinase, at least that one paper that reported that. Thanks. So, yes.
I'm curious to know if there's a recommendation on how long a patient should wait before having a catheter reinserted after it's taken out after a fungal infection.
There's no specific recommendation from the ISPD. You know, that's a very good question because we all know that inflammation sometimes in these patients goes on for a long time. And it's a bit of a tough one. Let's just say in our center, I can't speak for individual people, but generally speaking, we probably get them back on within about 6 to 8 weeks. And we often will treat them not for 3 weeks or 2 weeks with antifungals. We've had some unfortunate episodes, which, again, there's no evidence for this, but where we've treated for 2 or 3 weeks and found that they're still inflamed. And still, sometimes you went and re-ultrasound them, you found fluid and with signs of inflammation. So we often will treat these people for 4 weeks, and if clinically they're doing well, by 6, latest 8 weeks, they have a new catheter. And yes.
Hi, my question is the antifungal prophylaxis or the antibiotic fungal treatment should be within when we finish the antibiotics or a week after as well. What is the best practice?
Well, again, the literature on this is a little obscure. So the ones that we came across, so the first study I told you about, the Restrepo study, basically treated them for either 3 weeks while on antibiotics for peritonitis, or during the duration of antibiotics. So if it was 2 weeks, they didn't get into the fine details of the, but generically speaking, it was either 3 weeks or the duration of treatment with antibiotics. Other studies that I've come across have either continued it on for a few more days, or just the duration of treatment. Again, there's no real good answer to that. It's variable, but at the very least, it's during the duration of treatment with antibiotics for peritonitis or for possibly other indications. Where? Yes.
Hi, Hi, I was just curious. I don't have a lot of experience with fungal infections. If in the studies that you were looking at, if there was any research done about if the fungal peritonitis was the primary site of fungal infection or if it was a secondary site, were they looking at if it was oral or vaginal as a primary and then it was a spread?
Yeah, you know, there isn't, I know exactly what you're saying. So, you know, when they talk primary, it's just basically to exclude the antibiotic associated, which obviously has implications on what we might do for patients. Certainly, there are going to be patients who have another site of fungal infection. So I think in one of the studies, one or two patients had another site. I think one of them had an exit site infection that then became a peritonitis. But they didn't get into fine details around the primary. It just wasn't there. But certainly that exists. So I think primary is lumped into one environment, in one pot. And even in the first study, you know, just the definition itself of greater than 30 days to me was a bit of a question mark because what about at, you know, 2 weeks? There was nothing more specific than that. Okay, without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Cheryl Zelenitsky, who is my colleague and collaborator, and we've recently started collaborating in some wonderful projects, one of which she'll be presenting today. She's a professor of pharmacy at the University of Manitoba. Her area of focus in her research has to do with optimal use of antimicrobials in high-risk patients, so she's done research, and she's very broadly published in areas of critical care, of surgery, and now dialysis, actually even historically dialysis, because this is a repeat study from something that was done in another era when Adrian Fine was around. But without further ado, I would like to introduce Cheryl to talk to us about microbiology and PD. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank the committee for the invitation to present to you today. It's a pleasure to be in Vancouver in this beautiful conference room. So my talk today is going to focus on the microbiology, so talking about boring, but I'll try not to bore you to death. So this is the data from, in my presentation, is really from a study that we published recently in PDI, and it was looking at the microbiology and, importantly, also the resistance in PD isolates. We looked at PD or peritonitis over 10 years, from 2005 to 2014. It was a very nice collaborative effort. So Dr. Sathya Nathan and Verrelli from nephrology, Dr. Ariano and Davis from pharmacy, Philip Legassi-Weens is our clinical microbiologist at St. Boniface Hospital, and then we had an excellent student, J.C. Haworth, who's now graduated, a pharmacy student that helped with the data collection. This study was a redo because I had published a study back in the 90s with Dr. Fine. From 91 to 98, we described the peritonitis microbiology and resistance, and that study has been around a long time. Dr. Verrelli approached me to actually redo this study. I think he'd been interested in updating it for a while, and nobody took it on. I actually was very happy to collaborate again on this study. One of the reasons is that study from 1991 to 98 is my highest referenced article in my career, and not because it was spectacular, but because there's so little information in this area specific to peritoneal dialysis. And so it was always irritating when I saw that study referenced in 2017-16, because it's such old data and micro changes. So I think it was an important study to redo. The objectives are very simple. They are in the outline, so I won't go through them again. So I'll just start by, I will kind of talk about our data in three different parts. One will be kind of the microbiology, the percentage of isolates that are staph versus strep, that type of thing. I'll also talk about rates, because that is an important way to present this data, and most people, at least most of the literature, does not report rates specific to bacteria or to the microorganism. And then I want to talk a little bit about applying microdata to practice. So what I've done on my slides, and these are, you can download them, I wanted to show how little data there is in this area. PD is really, they're a special population, an important population, and the bugs that we see in peritonitis and what the microbiology and resistance looks like is extremely important to know, and there's very little data. I went and looked worldwide, and I found four other studies that actually looked at microbiology of PD over time. I had some criteria. I only looked at studies that had at least 200 episodes and that had an overlap of at least 2 years with our time frame, so they had to include at least 2005 and 2006. And after an exhaustive review, I came up with two Australian studies, one Western Australia, the other was Brisbane, a German study that was published last year in PLOS One, and then a study from Turkey. So overall, we looked at 539 episodes over the 10 years, and as a broad stroke, about two-thirds of the isolates were gram-positive, one quarter were gram-negative. We actually parceled out mixed infections, gram-positive and negative. Those accounted for 5%, and fungal 5%. So very broad look, and that was consistent with the other studies that I have listed on this slide. Again, when I looked at three different types. So peritonitis being single organism peritonitis. I also looked for information on the polymicrobial or more than one organism. Those are a different type of infection. And then the relapse infection that Dr. Verrelli defined. So when we look at single organism peritonitis, there were 427 cases over that 10 years, and a third of them were coag-negative staph, and that included staph epi and other. Staph epi were about 70% of that, so that's in the purple. Strep was actually the next most common gram-positive isolate causing peritonitis. I think this is underappreciated in the literature, at least. Staph aureus and then Enterococcus. Enterobacteriaceae most often were E. coli and Klebsiella, and they were in 15% of cases. I've combined Acinetobacter and Pseudomonas, the non-fermenters. They were 5%, and then there were others. So just to demonstrate kind of what the big difference is among the different types of peritonitis, this graph is really just the last one from the previous slide, that single organism. So how does this compare to when we look at polymicrobial peritonitis? We had 74 cases, 173 isolates within those cases. And so I've kind of, the colors do correspond to the same bugs, but I've kind of parceled out where the big differences were, which you can expect. Enterobacteriaceae are significantly more common in the polymicrobial. The polymicrobial are more often that GI source of bacteria, so you get your E. coli, especially E. coli. Anaerobes also, again, because of GI source, not something we saw in any single organism cases. The other just interesting observation with the polymicrobial, we didn't have one staph aureus isolate in any polymicrobial. They all tended to be the coag-negative staph or strep in combination if they were gram-positive. So staph aureus was not seen. I'm just at the bottom of that slide. I just summarized that for polymicrobial peritonitis, 40% about were gram-positive plus a gram-negative. 34% were 2 gram-positives. That's an important category within polymicrobial because that does represent more of a skin contaminant, a strep and a staph, for example. So it's unlike the polymicrobial that have a gram-negative from a GI. The other category, again, just to demonstrate the difference, the top slide is a little bit different than my previous one, which was the single organism. This is all new peritonitis, so when I say new, it's going to include my single organism and the polymicrobial. So new cases of peritonitis versus what Mauro talked about was the relapse peritonitis, so that is going to be the same organism that recurs within 4 weeks of completing antibiotic therapy. And how does that look compared to new? And as you can see in the relapse peritonitis, coag-negative staph is your bug. So it is more than half the cases, followed by staph aureus. So if you look at staph, it's going to be 70% of the time that relapse is going to be a staph. It certainly is related to biofilm and the inability of antibiotics alone to clear an infection where there is a significant biofilm component. So just to summarize again, this more broader global view of the microbiology, in our cases over the 10 years, peritonitis was associated with a single organism in 85% of the cases, and 15% were polymicrobial. Gram-positive was certainly the most common. In polymicrobial peritonitis, they're more likely, obviously, to involve enterobacteriaceae and anaerobes, less likely Staph aureus, and relapse peritonitis due to staph in 70% of cases. Now, that type of data is at least somewhat available in the literature and I think is important, but really, and as was mentioned in the 2016 guidelines, it is, when we look at just percentages of organisms that cause peritonitis, it doesn't represent the true picture. I feel bad with people behind me. It doesn't represent the whole picture of peritonitis, because as you can imagine, if you have a drop in your gram-positive rates, the relative percentage of gram-negatives just goes up as a number. But that doesn't mean your gram-negative infections are more common in your patients. And that's why it's important to look at rates. And there's little, if any, studies that have actually reported rates of episodes per patient year, say, for Pseudomonas. So those are the numbers that actually tell you something about your patients and what's going on. So I've made that attempt here. So when I'm looking here at trends in the rates of peritonitis, so now we're not looking at the percentage of bugs, but the trends in the rate, again, our study at the top, and I'll just draw attention to the fact that I'm looking here at culture positive. I'm also using the parameter recommended in the guidelines of the episodes per patient year. So over the 10 years in our study, we had a culture positive rate of 0.31. For those that use the infections per month, that equates to one infection per 38 months. The reason I did not include culture negative in this number, in this particular study, was that we used a different method to track the culture negative peritonitis. So it wasn't really apples and apples. And in our publication, I actually present the culture negative rates and that separately. But in general, you can see over this period of time, we had 0.31. And I think if I added the culture negative cases, it would be around the 0.38 that Dr. Verrelli presented in our 2016 data. With this analysis, as you can see, I'm down one study because that German study fell off. They only looked at percentage of isolates. They didn't look at any rates. So I kept as comparisons a Western Australia, the Brisbane study, and the one from Turkey, although you can notice in the Turkish study, the culture negative rate was 49%. So I'm not certain that how that affects the results, but I was trying to be generous in keeping studies on the list because there's so little in the literature. So what I've done in this slide is I've actually looked at our culture positive peritonitis, and just for interest, I added our data from the 1991 through 1998 time period, just to demonstrate to you how the rates had changed. And so this is culture positive. The black line is total infections. These are new. This does not include relapses, so any new single or polymicrobial. The purple is within that total, the gram-positive infection rate, the gram-negative in red, and then in our recent study, I added rates for fungal and mixed infections separately. So as you can see, and I think this speaks to Dr. Verrelli's topic about the Y connections and the improvements in the performance of the newer techniques to administer peritoneal dialysis, in the 90s, this is what we saw. So you can see how rates really went down. As you can also see in the last decade, the rate has stayed approximately the same over time. That 0.31 is just our average total. These were the rates in the three studies that I used as comparators. You can see that in the Turkish study and the Australian study, they were early on in our time frame. And that one study from Western Australia, and I'll just mention the Australian studies were huge. They use these huge databases for their renal program. Started out high. I think they started that study in 2008, and the rate over the time to 2013 came down to something similar to ours. So this is what I was mentioning before about the importance of actually looking at your rates of peritoneal dialysis-related peritonitis when it's organism-specific. And as opposed to just saying that staph epi and or coag-negative staphs accounts for two-thirds of your isolates, what did the rates of staph epi peritonitis look like? And what did the rates of staph aureus peritonitis look like? And again, what I've done on this slide, the y-axis has changed. On the previous one, the upper maximum number was 1, so I've just kind of blown it up here. But the staph epi, as you can see, came down during the 90s. It's a variable rate over time. Now, granted, when I get to this kind of analysis, we're kind of chopping up the pie, so you get more variability. But the staph epi rate is in the dark purple. The light purple is the staph aureus, so not significant changes over the period of time from 2005 to 14. And then what I did do in this study is I added the streptococcus. Some of that has to do with the ability to identify that organism. In the 90s, the techniques used by the microlab weren't perhaps identifying the strept. They're a bit more finicky to grow in the lab. So this is data that I added, and you can see that streptococcus has a pretty good appearance there when you look at it compared to staph. These are the rates of our gram-negative peritonitis, again, looking back at our previous study and in our newer study. So E. coli in red, and overall maybe a little bit lower in the more recent, but relatively stable. And if we look at the one that changed significantly was Pseudomonas. So back in the 90s, you can see the Pseudomonas, although it was up and down, that overall rate was quite a bit higher than we're seeing in the last 10 years, which is a good thing. The other just note on this slide is that gray is a combination of Acinetobacter and Pseudomonas, so it's both bugs. So that's just something to just keep in mind if you're looking at this study later on. So as a summary, the rates of peritonitis following significant reductions in the 90s were relatively stable from 2005 to 2014 with an average rate of one infection every 38 months. Notably, the organism-specific rates, which are rarely reported in the literature, were also relatively stable during that time. So this is, I think, the important part of this presentation, and it's looking at antimicrobial resistance within the PD population. And it is, as Dr. Verrelli mentioned, a recommendation that we know the population of bugs that you're dealing with. And when we look also at antibiotic therapies, which will be the last part of my talk, it is a fairly scarce literature based on antibiotics and how well they work and what we should be using in peritonitis. So this is kind of information I think is important to know up front to look at what those rates of resistance are. So I put this up just to kind of put it into some context. This was a document, a report that was released by the WHO. I believe it was just in February or March. It's within the last month or two. And what they did in this report is identify critical bugs where resistance is of a global concern. And they had three priority lists. I just listed one and two here for us today. The critical bugs identified were Acinetobacter, specifically carbapenem resistant. So those would be resistant to meropenem, imipenem. Pseudomonas aeruginosa, also with carbapenem resistance being a concern. Enterobacteriaceae, E. coli, and Klebsiella, specifically looking at ESBLs, those extended spectrum beta-lactamases that are resistant, not to all cephalosporins, including ceftazidime. If we go down then to the high priority list, Enterococcus faecium, VRE, or vancomycin resistant, and methicillin-resistant staph aureus. So how does that work into the context of PD? So here is our pie graph, and I have sliced out the pieces of the pie that are on that list, at the top five, basically, on the WHO list, and those are one-third of the bugs that you see in peritonitis. So this is a significant, now I'm not saying the resistance is there in peritonitis, and I'll show you some of the data to show where at least we are right now as far as the resistance, but I think as clinicians and practitioners and researchers, it's important that we know that you're sitting with a population where one-third of the bacteria that you're seeing are on this list. So if they're not resistant now, it's certainly something we need to be watching and planning for in the future. So there's a little bit more data on microbiology, and I know that when we look at micro, what does a study from Brazil mean to Winnipeg, or what does a study from Australia mean to Vancouver? But I tried again to be complete in this review, looking at how, you know, where is the data that is looking at microbial resistance in PD patients. So this is a comprehensive list, again, of all the studies that I could find. Ours at the top, and what I did in the first row is indicate the number of isolates that we tested in our study. And in our study, I tried to be, when you're looking at resistance rates, there's a point at which you don't have enough bugs to actually have meaningful data. So if you're testing five bugs and one is resistant, you have a 20% rate. Well, that's could be a fluke. So I tried to be somewhat conservative. And then in the studies that I've listed down, again, more for your information for those that may be interested, you could see that even when we look at resistance and studies of resistance in PD patients, the data is scarce. The Brazilian study, the two at the top, only looked at coag-negative staph and at staph aureus. The Australian studies only looked at coag-negative staph and staph aureus. Brazil added in strept, which was nice because it's the only study outside of ours that looked at strept resistance. And we don't think of strept as being really resistant, but we did find a significant number, actually, that were resistant to penicillin. The North Indian study, I've kept it on, and what might North India mean to us in Winnipeg? Well, not much, but I was so desperate to get data on Acinetobacter, for example, that I've included it here. There was a Spanish study. Unfortunately, they had a really good, they looked at all the bugs that we did, but they only measured Cipro. And then the German study back from the beginning of my talk, they also looked at resistance rates and were pretty comprehensive in the bugs that they looked at. So I've summarized this for us, and I'll just orientate. I realize I don't have y-axis labels. So what that is just percentage of resistance in peritoneal dialysis. And staph aureus is the first three columns there. And that is the resistance rate. So in the first column, the 57% that you see is MRSE. That's methicillin resistance in your staph epi, and it was 57% over that 10 years. So about 60% of staph epi are resistant to methicillin, so that would be the ones requiring the vancomycin. An interesting observation in this study, and intuitively I knew it, but I didn't realize that in PD, coag-negative staph is often just, we clump it together as one group. They're very different in resistance profiles. So outside of staph epi, the common coag-negative staphs, if your sites, I don't know if your sites actually provide you that, the detail, or if they just report coag-negative staph other than staph epi, but there's a staph warnii, a staph hemolyticus, and a hominis. Those were the three most common in these other coag-negative staphs. Those tend to not harbor the methicillin or oxacillin resistance like staph epi does. So they only have a 20% resistance rate, which means that they can be treated without vancomycin. So it is important. I don't think any of the other studies actually made that differentiation. They often just kind of clump everything together. The bars that you will see on the next couple of graphs that have red, those are the WHO concerns. And you can see that our MRSA rate was very low, 11%. So it's a very low rate. The bars that I've put up here is we went back and looked at the hospital-wide resistance during our study time to kind of compare PD patients to hospitalized patients. And as you can see, our PD patients have lower resistance rates or had lower resistance rates. Our institutional resistant rate for MRSA over that time is about 20%, whereas our PD isolates were only 11%. So that's a good news story. In the 90s, our MRSA rate was 2%. So, you know, it certainly jumped up over that period of time. The streptococcus in the second, or I guess underneath the streptococcus graph, is 32% penicillin resistant. So these are streps that are resistant. They will come up as resistant to penicillin, which means that they are resistant to cefazolin or will be reported that way. So that was a number that I didn't expect. Our VRE is quite low. We only had 3% VRE, so a very low number. And I'll skip over this for those that are interested in looking later. I just graph for you the rates at the other sites or other studies. This is the resistance in gram negatives. And so the first is the E. coli and the second is Klebsiella. And as a clinician, there are a couple of important things to kind of realize when we look at resistance in the gram negatives. So I'm going to start with E. coli. So as you can see there, our E. coli has a resistance rate of 20% to cefazolin, so one out of five. Now you'll notice I have little brackets under that, that was only 2012 to 14 data, and that is because the microbiology labs, and this happened across Canada, so it'll apply to your site, they changed the definition of resistance for the Enterobacteriaceae and the cefazolin. And they changed it by making, they actually made it harder to report it as a sensitive. So rates of resistance went up from 2012 to 13, like a jump. And that was because of the criteria that they were using. And they made that change in an attempt to better identify ESBLs. Because if you have a resistant E. coli to cefazolin now with that lower breakpoint, it makes it easier for them to identify it as an ESBL. So it was a 20% rate in that time, which is quite, I think is notable. We had a 43% resistance to cefazolin for Klebsiella. It tends to be more resistant to cefazolin. The Cipro resistance, so when we published, I think our paper actually came out in the printed journal last week, and in the editorial they actually say that we have some good news in our study because resistant rates were relatively low overall, but they pointed to the Cipro resistance as a not so good news story in our study. And the Cipro resistance for E. coli was 24%. So it was high, it was 3% in the 90s. Now that 24%, that also undercalls it, because the resistance was something like 20% in the first half of our study and 40-some percent in the second half of our study. So today, if we looked at Cipro-resistant E. coli in this population, my guess is it's closer to 40% as a real number. So we have lost Cipro to a great degree, and it's not, it has nothing to do with nephrology. It's not, you're snickering, it's not your fault. You know, we just blew it with the quinolones in the 90s when we used them for CAP, and everybody that had a sniffle was getting levoquin and moxi. So this is something that we've seen across the board. And I know it is a, it can be a valuable agent, especially when you're looking at nephrology or peritoneal dialysis for things like Pseudomonas, where you run out of options perhaps. But the resistance in the Enterobacteriaceae is an issue. The good news, we didn't find any ESBLs at all during that 10 years. And when I look at some of the other data out of our region at least, ESBLs in E. coli, about 10% in hospitalized patients, bacteremic patients, we have these E. coli's that are resistant to ceftazidime. And they're not in PD, although let me qualify, they weren't in PD patients between 2005 and 14, but that is because PD patients' profiles look a little bit more like community patients than they do hospital. But once ESBLs get into a population, then they're there and the rates go up. So we're at a time where we haven't noticed them, but it's certainly one to watch because, as I mentioned, I know that they're in other populations at in our region at least. I think another good news is the Pseudomonas. So for Pseudomonas, I've reported here ceftazidime, peptazo, cipro, and gent resistance, and you can see it's very, very low. Pseudomonas is more sensitive to cipro than E. coli is, which is would be something that people may not intuitively think about. But the Pseudomonas we saw was very sensitive. The Acinetobacter was actually quite interesting. Not a common bug, and there have been a few studies that have actually focused on Acinetobacter. It's kind of one of these concerning, maybe emerging bugs that you worry about. It tends to hold resistance genes to an array of antibiotics, so it's not unusual to see Acinetobacter that's resistant to multi-drugs. In our population, we only had about 20 isolates. However, our meropenem resistance, so this is that carbapenemase resistance to the big guns, was 8%. And that was the exact same number as was published actually in the same issue of PDI with our paper from Hong Kong that showed an 8% resistance of carbapenemases. If you have an Acinetobacter infection that's carbapenem resistant, you are going to some very nasty drugs to treat those infections, things like colistin, polymyxin B, that we dug out of the 60s or 50s, and nobody used them because they were too toxic. So in summary, staph resistant, we had 57% MRSE, so in epi, and 11% MRSA, less than hospital-wide resistance rates. VRE was very rare. E. coli, 20% resistance to cefazolin, and most concerning would be the 24% resistant to cipro. We had no ESBLs, but just to show that global rates, and again, China and India may not be the comparable places, but we are looking at upwards of 30, 40, 50, or 60% in some of those regions. Pseudomonas was highly susceptible, and Acinetobacter, I did make a mental note of that resistance rate because I think it is something to actually think about and watch. So now just to wrap up with some data on applying micro to peritonitis, because in the area of PD, we get these reports of this bug is sensitive or this bug is resistant, but what does that mean? And my short answer is probably little. it's informative, but it's not like us getting micro results from a bloodstream infection in an ICU patient, and you're like, okay, it's sensitive to this, 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 and it's resistant to that, that, and that. In this area, you kind of look at these, and it's a little bit more complicated than that. The reason is because in microbiology, these cutoffs for calling something susceptible or calling something resistant is based on plasma levels and patients that have systemic infections. Those breakpoints, those definitions were not developed for peritonitis, specifically not for when you're treating it with IP antibiotics. So we did something in this study to kind of take it to that level. And I'll just kind of explain this table first. So what we did in this table is we looked at every new case of peritonitis, and I wanted to look at how did our empiric therapies measure up, just based on susceptibility. So in the first column, we looked at cefazolin and Tobra, and in the second column, Vanco and Tobra. And we went back, because when you're treating empirically, we don't know what we're treating, right? You're just kind of throwing a broad spectrum kind of regimen at the patient, hopefully to cover you well enough until you get those micro results back. We still, or at the time, and still use the cefazolin tobramycin. Other sites may have gone to Vanco tobramycin. And so what we did with this case is I said, okay, we're going to take our 501 cases and retrospectively say how many of those cases were resistant to our initial regimen. As I mentioned, when you're doing empirically going forward, you don't know that, but we had the luxury of having all these cases and all the microbiology on it, so we could kind of go back and test how well we did. The cefazolin plus tobramycin, and I've kind of put a box around the resistant, 25%, 26% of our cases would have been resistant to the cefazolin tobra. So one out of four were not covered. And we looked at every specific bug, and we looked at cefazolin and gentamicin separately, or tobramycin, sorry, separately. Often what you'll see in studies is people assume that aminoglycosides have no gram-positive coverage. Actually, they do. They have actually very good gram-positive coverage. It's not reliable for therapy because the bugs actually become tolerant to the aminoglycoside. As far as having activity, at least initially, they do have, and the resistance rates are often quite low to things like staph. Not good against strep, but certainly to staph. Now, when I would have applied that, or when we applied that analysis to vancomycin, you could see that 10% were resistant. So you're sitting with this situation where you know that moving forward, your empiric therapy is going to be resistant and not cover 25% of your cases. If you switch to vanco and tobra, you're not going to cover 10%. So there's almost, well, there is a 15% kind of gain by doing the vanco option. There were two studies, the Belgium one, I haven't referred to it before, but it was actually one study that actually did something similar to what we did. It was a small study. They mixed adult and pediatrics, I believe, in that study. They kind of did what we did, and they found that at the time they were using cefazolin ceftazidime, and they found only a 68% coverage. And they actually used that data to switch to vancomycin. They dropped their ceftazidime because of concerns for resistance, although I don't know that quinolones are a better option for that reason. But they actually used their microdata to switch their empiric therapy. The German study that I've referred to a couple of times actually did the same. They are ones that went from cefazolin gent, and as you can see there, they only looked at gram-positive and negatives. But they thought that because cefazolin did not have good gram-positive coverage at only 58%, they switched to vancogent. And so you can look at the kind of specifics, but basically what they thought is similar to us. They looked at that data saying we're not covering as many organisms with the cefazolin, so we're going to go to vanco. Now, a couple of things to be cognizant of in this case is that when you're looking at this kind of data, you have to see what you're missing. So what you're missing in that 25%? Well, you're going to be missing anaerobes and fungi. And that's going to be whether you're using vanco or cefazolin. So that doesn't make a difference. But that 15% gain for the vanco arm or the vanco option is enterococcus, the staphs and streps that were resistant to cefazolin. So that is what you're getting. So that kind of puts it into context. So what do you do? Well, there's a couple of questions that people have to ask themselves when they're deciding on what is the appropriate empiric therapy. What is the right percentage? So this 25% number that we're missing with cefazolin and gent or tobra, that doesn't mean that all those patients fail. That's one thing. This is not directed therapy. And you want to look at this being empiric, and within hopefully your 48 hours, you will know that it is a methicillin-resistant Staph aureus and you're treating that patient with vanco. So this is empiric. The unfortunate thing about vancomycin is once you give that first dose, that patient has it for a week. So it's not like switching therapy. And that's really what kind of draws some sites back from committing to vanco, because what you're doing essentially is committing every single patient to vanco, because a week of therapy is, you know, half your duration. So that's really something that has to be considered. And then my last question here is, does resistance correlate to treatment outcomes? Because if that 25% in other things, if this is a bacteremia and you said you're treating empirically with something that it's resistant to, and it's one quarter of your patients, nobody would tolerate it, right? You're not going to want to do that. Because that correlates to outcomes. If we have a bacteremic patient in an ICU and it's an MRSA and we treat with clocks, that patient is going to do poor. We know that. In this arena, that's not as clear. So there's two points I put on here. There's probably a third to consider. And one is, in peritonitis, we have much higher concentrations. So this is a graph from a study that was looking at cefazolin. They gave a single dose. In this case, I believe it was 1,500 milligrams IP. The higher graph at the top, that's the concentrations in the peritoneal fluid, which we consider at the site of infection. Very, very high, 5,400 milligrams per liter. The bottom graph there is the concentrations in the serum or in the plasma that have come back, that have transferred back from the peritoneal cavity. So those are the concentrations we're looking at in peritoneal dialysis and the treatment. As a comparator, if we were using a 2-gram cefazolin Q8, so kind of the highest dose in a patient with normal kidneys, the peaks in the plasma are about 150 milligrams per liter. So they're higher than what you're getting actually in the serum from giving it IP, but they're not nearly as high as what the local environment is seeing at least once a day. So that's one thing to consider. The other thing to consider is that in PD fluid, antibiotics do not work the same. They do not kill bacteria the same way as they do in broth, which is our kind of laboratory environment, or in plasma. This is just, there's been several studies in the last few years looking at this at this phenomenon. These graphs are kill curves, so it was the number of bacteria that are killed over 24 hours. I did, in this case, I just picked out the vancomycin, so this is looking at vancomycin, and the different graphs or lines there are just different concentrations of the vanco. But the graph on the left-hand side is the antibiotic activity in broth. So that's kind of what we normally think. So vancomycin kills, as you can see there, about 3 to 4 logs over 24 hours. The graph on the right is the activity of vancomycin in diarrheal fluid. So it's about half as active. So that's another important thing. This phenomenon has been shown with staph, with E. coli, with enterococcus. It tends to be the beta-lactams that are not as active. I think it's probably because of the bugs are not growing as quickly in the diarrheal fluid, and the beta-lactams kind of need that cell wall activity to be active. So what does this mean? And this is my last slide, so I'm okay. What does this mean? So what do we do with cefazolin and vanco, as our options? And I'm hesitant to jump on the microbiology part of it. And in the past, we looked at things like MRSE. And if someone was being treated with cefazolin and Natobra, we thought that we weren't getting any activity. But we've shown that the combination of the two actually are quite active against staph epi, even if it's methicillin resistant. Now, it's not something I would treat long term, but I'm comfortable with an MRSE that if you have that aminoglycoside on board, at least for empiric therapy. So the answer to this really is two. If you want to be very conservative, then you go to the vanco and Tobra, and you're knowing that you're covering at least 90% of those patients. You're missing the fungi, you're missing the anaerobes, but you're good with that, and you're good with exposing every patient that has peritonitis to vancomycin for a week. The other option is saying, I don't really believe that this 25% resistance in cefazolin Tobra is indicative of clinical outcome, and unless we're seeing a lot of failure rates, which is the thing we need to look at, is what are the failure rates to actually answer this question, we're comfortable staying with the cefazolin Tobra, being on top of the micro and making sure that we make the change when we get back that result from microbiology. In the micro area, and I did contact our microbiologist before I came to Vancouver, because there's something, some of you may be familiar with MALDI-TOF, which is a mass spec way of diagnosing bacteria, and they've actually implemented it in hospitals now to diagnose or to identify bloodstream infections. And instead of having this 24 hours to grow the bug and another 24 hours for susceptibilities, they can get data back to you within 4 to 6 hours of what that bug is in a bloodstream. So it depends on what they're using as far as the sample and the fluid. And I did contact Philip and said, like, any, you know, opportunities? And I'm sure there's opportunities in PD. I would be very surprised if there wasn't. Nobody's looking at it because it's a small population. But peritoneal fluid might be a good place, and you could have results back. Instead of waiting 2 days, you could have them back within the day, which I think is something to maybe keep your eye on and look into, and you may have to advocate for some work in that area. The only clinical work that I found that was relevant to this issue was a meta-analysis done and looking at our two regimens. So I'll just explain. This is clinical outcome, clinical success with using empiric therapy. And the red, we'll focus on the red, is cefazolin and tobramycin. And those confidence intervals, based on all the studies that have been basically published on cefazolin and tobramycin or gentamicin, have shown a kind of clinical success rate in that range of 0.6 to 0.75. So that's for empiric therapy. They also looked at any studies that did vanco and tobra, and they came out with a confidence interval that was shifted a bit to the right, so a bit better, but concluded that there was no difference in the outcomes of patients based on picking an empiric therapy with vanco and tobra versus cefazolin tobra. So we sit with cefazolin and tobra still. And with that, I'd like to thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Let me introduce myself. My name is Mrinal Dasgupta, and I had been working on this problem for many, many years. And if you can show me your third slide with the pie diagram, if it's possible, then I'd like to make a comment for the audience and also for the perspective of this Western PD meeting, okay, which is going on for 25 years.
Sorry, which slide would you like?
The third slide of your pie diagram when you started.
Oh, okay.
You showed the bacterial growth, and after relapse, how the pie diagram changed after treatment, way back in the...
Oh, okay, sorry. Oh, with the relapse, that's this one you're talking about.
Yeah, the two pie diagram, one on the top, one on the bottom.
Yeah, sorry, okay.
Okay, what I was trying to say is that I'm glad that Dr. Verrelli got you involved in working in this area of peritonitis and you with your microbiology expertise. But in this diagram, what you have shown, that by adapting to clean hygiene and avoiding touch contamination, okay, the relapsed peritonitis is an entity, which is mm-hmm. in the second pie diagram, and all the PD units are working on that. Because when a patient comes, we put them on PD and then they become successful, get transplanted, or something happened. But those who are really enjoying the benefit of the PD treatment are having to face this problem. Mm-hmm. So that is a message. And we have been giving this message year after year and trying to find out what's the progress. What is wonderful that by having a clinical question given to you, and with your dedication, you have taken it to another height, suggesting what should be the routine protocol and how you do advance the protocol based on your own data. Mm-hmm. And I congratulate you for that. I'll be watching for your further publications. The one thing we suggested that once the biofilm is grown, Staphylococcus, Pseudomonas, and yes, fungal peritonitis, no question asked, yes, take that catheter out. You, yes, won't be able to do anything. Okay. The third thing is that in terms of peritonitis infection, if we have to compare and learn from another person, the gold standard are the Japanese data. And in your analysis, you haven't shown any Japanese data. Mm-hmm. Australia and Canada, we can equate, particularly in terms of the healthcare model, how we take care of our patients.
Yeah.
And but the Japanese have a different culture and different cleanliness, and their peritonitis rate is extremely, extremely mm-hmm. low.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, why didn't you look at the Japanese data?
Okay, thank you for the comments and the question. Just quickly on this graph, this does not mean that we're not treating coag-negative staph appropriately. It tends to be the one that relapses because we are treating it in the patient. We're not pulling those catheters like we would a fungal catheter. So these are just the result of the relapse happening. Maybe, like Dr. Verrelli's mentioned, treat for a longer period of time. So this does not indicate that what we're doing is not correct. As far as the Japanese data, I am familiar with that data, and it is actually very, very good data. It looks over decades. Its focus was a little bit more on different processes, like the Y connection and twin bagging and the effects of that on peritonitis rates. And then in the second cohort, they looked at different diurnal fluids and the effects of that on their rates. So yes, you're right, they have very good data. It tends to be more global data on rates of peritonitis, and it doesn't really get down to the individual bugs and the microbiology that I was presenting today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, I think in the interest of time, we'll cut off there. Thank you very much, Mauro and Cheryl, for some great presentations. You can hunt them down afterwards downstairs and get them. So next steps we're going to go is just to our first break of the morning. Again, break downstairs. There will be some refreshments, and the sponsors are down there. We'll have everybody back to get started again for 11:15 for the second part of the morning. Anything else? Oh, bathrooms are downstairs if anybody needs. Thanks.